Good morning and Happy New Year 2021. During this pandemic, many children and teachers have not yet returned to the schools. A large number of learners, as well as teachers, are still using remote learning, strengthening a number of platforms via the internet, TV, radio, social media, and materials developed for modules. These remain essential. Some countries in Southeast Asia had the opportunities to reopen by zoning method, and some are still waiting for potentials for school reopening. Thought leaders believe that schooling must be a priority, of course, notwithstanding the health and the food distribution concerns. Majority of our countries in the region utilize blended learning, combining that partial school attendance a few days in a week, reduced school days with social distancing protocols, security protocols, avoiding the physical presence of older teachers, etc. With remote learning modular instructions, these assist in building back better to the new normal. Today, we offer another round of special lecture series to help us navigate remote teaching and learning. This lecture series with our partners will offer three sessions, starting today on February 4th and February 18th. So we thank you for your participation in this morning's session. We will learn the newest technological solutions and innovative strategies for improving teacher capacity. teaching pedagogies and student learning processes, as well as developing future skills of students and teachers, even during the lockdown. The SEAMEO Secretariat collaborated with global education partners, intergovernmental organizations, development agencies, private enterprises to organize this special SEAMEO-Partners Lecture Series 2021. It takes a village to raise a child. That's an African proverb. Thus, SEAMEO and partner organizations are bringing new insights and pedagogical tools for the teachers and learners. We'd like to express our appreciation to our 18 partners who have shared their expertise and initiatives to address the learning loss. In spite that this educational disruption is still here during the pandemic. We would also like to thank our ministers of education in Southeast Asian countries and our 26 regional centers who are helping us disseminate the information of pedagogical tools, techniques, newest program to help us survive in this new normal. We fully hope that educators and students alike can learn a lot from this lecture series. To start the session, I would like to call on Mr. Rafael Cada, our Program Officer for Policy and Development, and our Knowledge Management Office Manager, Ms. Piapa, to handle the session. May I turn over the session to you? Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ethel. A pleasant morning to all our viewers, to the educators in Southeast Asia and beyond. Good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. And welcome to this lecture series, this time with our partners. Piapa, would you like to greet our audience?
Thank you, Laffy, and good morning, everyone, again. And very nice to see you again for this morning session.
Yes, for this lecture series, Dr. Ethel mentioned that this is the first of the three. How many lectures are we expecting for these presentations, Piapa?
Yes, for the whole three sessions, we received the support from our 18 partners who submit about nearly 30 videos to take part in the SEAMEO Partner Lecture Series. And each presentation, they offer the opportunities for our participants to grab and then to join their program. So at the end of each presentation, please pay attention to the QR code or web link that the participant can register to participate in the partners program with free of charge. They don't need to pay anything and join that program. And for today's session, we have about four chapters. The first one from a keynote speaker presentations, and the second, improving school capacity. And the third chapter is about innovative teacher training. And the last chapter is about new skill for teacher. And we have about 10 presentations today.
Oh, okay. So on our YouTube Live, we have more than 600 of them joining us. So please prepare your handphones, capture all the links, the QR code, so that you can enroll this from our partners, so that you will also benefit from their offerings and from the innovations. But before we go to the keynote presentation, we'd like to share with you some two reminders. So we want to see your voice. First is that on our YouTube Live, we have pinned there a polling link. So please access that so that you can share with us the keywords that resonate with you after the presentation. So that's the first.
So they can type anything, right? Only one word.
Only one word.
Oh, wow.
One word that resonated with you, the ideas that you like. We're expecting huge traffic in this link. So if ever you fail or you find it difficult to access, there's the second chance. So we're requesting you to submit photo reflection, and you can email them at webinar@seameo. So what this photo reflection, we want to know how you are viewing this lecture series. Are you viewing it with your co-teachers?
Oh, really?
Are you back in your school? Are you in the comforts of your own home, accessing and learning together? Or are you streaming it in your online classes with your learners?
They can selfie themselves by using their mobile phone, and then send a photo to us.
To us, yes. You can email us at webinar@seameo.org. Or you can post them on your own social media channel. Just use the hashtag SEAMEO Partners. You can see it at the bottom right part of the screen. so that we can also see them. Mm-hmm. And we will feature these photos that you shared with us, the ones that you emailed with us, or mm-hmm. the ones you shared on your own platform in the next lecture. Because oh. every Thursday is a SEAMEO mm-hmm. Learning Thursday for all of us here.
Yes, that's right. So we're looking forward to receiving the yes. polls, keywords from you, and also your photo reflecting yeah. about our lecture series.
Because we want to see their voices as
that's
well.
That's right. Okay, that's great. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so now let's proceed to the keynote presentation. So for the first part of this lecture series, we will have two keynote presentations. The first one will be from the International Council for Open and Distance Education, Norway. This will be delivered by Ms. Torun Gelsvik. And then we also have, she will also feature Dr. Wayne McIntosh, the OER Foundation and OERU facilitator of UNESCO ICD Chair in Open Education Resources. We also have a keynote presentation from University of Tsukuba to be delivered by Professor Dr. Masami Isoda, the director of CRICED. And he will talk about online program on teacher education for a new normal. So friends, let us learn and enjoy these lectures.
Let's enjoy.
Greetings from Norway. My name is Torun Gelsvik. I'm the Secretary General of the International Council for Open and Distance Education, ICDE. In this video, we will introduce to you the ICDE and the OER universities. We will also share information on a free and open online course to improve digital skills for educators and students. Finally, a recent graduate of one of the courses will share her experience of the course, including the benefits for participation. ICD is the leading global membership organization working to promote and advocate for open, flexible, and distance learning. ICD has more than 250 members and partners, impacting over 15 million students across six continents. The organization is in a consultative partnership with UNESCO and shares UNESCO's key value, the universal right to education to all. ICD deeply believes in the potential of open education to achieve education for all. Open education and open education resources, OER, has been a strategic priority for ICD over many years, and it is again an important focus in our current strategic plan for 2021-24. One of ICD's key partners in this field is OER Universitas, OERU. Coordinated by the OER Foundation, the OERU International Network of Institutions offer free online courses for students worldwide based entirely on OER. The course that will be presented today is part of the Learning in the Digital Age series of microcourses. It is aimed at developing the skills and confidence to become competent and autonomous learners in a digital age. To present this course, I will now leave the floor to the Managing Director of the OER Foundation, Wayne McIntosh.
Kia ora, and greetings from New Zealand. My name is Wayne McIntosh, and I'm the Managing Director of the OER Foundation, which is coordinating the implementation of the OERU. I also hold the UNESCO ICDE Chair in OER. At the OERU, we are collaborating with ICDE and UNESCO at the heart of the education endeavor. That is to share knowledge freely through open education. Our network of institutions has pioneered a transnational micro-credentialing system with pathways for learners to achieve formal academic credit. Powered by OER, you can study for free, and you don't need to buy expensive textbooks. Moreover, as OER, you have the freedom to share these courses with your own learners. And if you'd like, you can add value by translating these courses into local languages in your respective countries. Please join us in widening access to education for all. Today, I would like to introduce the Learning in a Digital Age series of microcourses. There are four microcourses, and each microcourse will take about 20 to 30 hours to complete. The course materials are designed for independent online study, and I recommend that you spend approximately 1 to 1.5 hours each working day for 2 weeks. Don't worry if you fall behind. Access to the course materials will remain open, and you can progress at your own pace as your work and personal commitments allow. This is a unique course because we don't use a learning management system. Our philosophy is to help learners to learn on the internet, and we use a component-based system using the tools of the internet rather than a single software application. Our learning environment is entirely open source, so you don't need to purchase any software licenses or sacrifice personal data to access the learning materials. Institutions are free to replicate our systems for their own use. All you need to do is select a micro course which attracts your interest and start learning today. You can earn digital participation badges for free, and we also offer a competency certification in copyright and Creative Commons licensing. Join over 8,000 learners from more than 90 countries who have participated in one or more of the Learning in a Digital Age microcourses. Registration is easy. Let me show you how. Go to the course page on the OERU website at oeru.org/leader. Click on the orange Sign Up It's Free button to register your interest to participate in one of the courses. So this will take you to a landing page where you can provide your details and email address for us to send you course instructions via email. Alternatively, you can go straight to the learning materials by clicking on the green Start Learning button here. This will take you to the course website where you can gain access to the course materials in the learning pathways. From the course website, you can also register to receive course instructions via email by clicking on the login register button on the top right of your screen. Click on the register link to register a new account and provide your details, and we will send you the course instructions via email. Finally, I would like to introduce Simone Wood from Otago Polytechnic in New Zealand. She's a recent graduate of the Learning in a Digital Age course, and as one of her course projects, she developed a short video providing further details of the course and its benefits for learners. I look forward to seeing you online, and I hope that you enjoy your learning experience with us.
It's often said that we live in a digital age. The ever-increasing reach of the internet into our everyday lives is changing how we learn from others and how we express ourselves. It's altering our concepts of knowledge and identity, and it's introducing new opportunities and risks. So how do you feel about learning on the internet? Is it like hanging out with friends? Or venturing into a money-grabbing marketplace controlled by distant corporations? Is it a place where you feel you have a right to stand and express yourself? Or a scary, threatening world that you don't dare to explore? It probably feels like all of these at different times. That's why we all need some help to navigate safely and confidently through this new environment. That's where the OERU's free online course, Learning in a Digital Age, comes in. You'll build up your knowledge and skills through four microcourses: digital literacies for online learning, digital citizenship, open education, copyright and open licensing, and critical media literacies. Let's take a look at what you'll learn. Digital literacies for online learning is like a navigation kit for learners, helping you find and evaluate educational resources and tools on the web. Digital citizenship helps you work out your place as a learner in this new world. What are your rights and responsibilities? How do you define and protect your online identity? In open education, copyright and open licensing, you'll discover the closed spaces of the internet and the open ones. Here you'll learn how you can find and contribute to open shared resources for learning. Finally, in critical media literacies, you'll learn the survival skills necessary to be a streetwise explorer in the digital world. This is where you'll learn how to evaluate news reports, work out who you can trust, track down facts that really are facts, and put your own messages out there in a compelling way. So, how will you feel at the end of Learning in a Digital Age? Something like this. So whether you're in formal education or simply learning day to day from the world around you, Learning in a Digital Age will give you the confidence to thrive as a learner in the digital world. Start learning now.
My name is Masami Soda, University of Tsukuba, Japan. Thank you very much for your participation of this short information. On this short information, I will announce the online program. It provides certification under the SEAMEO. Under the name of program is Teaching Mathematics to Develop Mathematical Thinking as Higher Order Thinking. Okay. And these programs are related with SEAMEO priority issues number 5, revitalizing teacher education, and number 7, adapting a 21st century curriculum. Okay. Objective of this class is to develop knowledge for teaching with a component of pedagogical content knowledge and subject matter knowledge for all school levels by using the materials up to third grade of elementary school. On every class, we provide the following question. How do you teach it? Why? Okay. Or how is related with the pedagogical question? However, for answering why, we have to have pedagogical content knowledge and the subject matter knowledge. And on this program, we share pedagogical content knowledge and subject matter knowledge for teaching. Those knowledge are necessary for teacher education. On that meaning, it will be useful also for math educator mathematicians and teachers to reconsider their teacher education. Please look at this page. This is from Japanese textbook. And Japanese approach is well known through the lesson study. This is the introduction page for the elementary grade, first grade, primary first grade. How do you teach? What do you teach? Why? Okay? For explaining, answering these kind of questions, we have to know what higher order thinking is hidden on this material. For answering, SEAMEO already developed the reference book. It is curriculum standard, C-base, CCRLS. It's published from the SEAMEO Lexham with collaboration of your curriculum specialist on your government. And please look at mathematical ideas for set, unit, and compare this part. Okay? If we use the idea of set, idea of unit, idea of compare, we can plan the activity. And if we can plan well, we can teach mathematical thinking and process through reflection and appreciation. Okay? If we appreciate the ideas well, it means that if we know mathematical value of ideas, mathematical values of ideas, student wanna use it. And another material we use, Japanese textbook. Japanese teaching approach are well known through the lesson study in the world. And some country already adopted Japanese textbook. Thailand, Indonesia, and so on. And in the case of Indonesia, they will not use this textbook nationally. Okay? This is the course schedule. 20 classes, every time 40 minutes. And we focus on number and operation up to third grade. It looks easier content, however, for understanding and for enjoy learning, we may need to understand it deeply. This is a way of participation. Online program, every time 40 minutes lectures and 20 classes. For the registration, please use this code. If you use this code, you can automatically participate in. And one of the problem of this course is 40 minutes lecture. And for deep understanding with enjoyable activities, we additionally provide the program is communication of researchers and lecturers. Such programs are provided by Konkan University and the UP Nisimet, University of the Philippines. Okay? And we are now discussing with other countries and the SEAMEO centers, how can we provide this program more deeply? Lastly, this is the reference. All products are related with the SEAMEO activity. We have the exercise book and so on for teacher training. Okay. So thank you very much for your participation. Looking forward to your participation to the program. Thank you very much.
Okay, so there we have seen the keynote presenters from ICDE and from the University of Tsukuba. At this point, we'd like to acknowledge the 960 participants joining us on YouTube Live. And they're enjoying, I think there's a question here asking about the link because ICDE, yeah, the LIDA about ICDE, they can watch this YouTube presentation later so that they will be refreshed.
Yeah, they can apply again.
Yeah, so that they'll be aware of the opportunities that was given by our partners.
Yes, that's right.
So Piapa, would you like to introduce the second chapter?
Yes, sure. Now we have about 950 participants, you know, watching us at the moment. So I think that because many of you are not able to enter the polling, because the polling is quite full already. Yeah. We are sorry for this because, you know, so high traffic.
Yeah.
You know, many people try to access the polling at the same time, and that's why it's got stuck, and now it's already full. So we would like to hear from you. That where are you from? Could you please type in the chat, YouTube, that the name of your institution, city, and country, so that we would know that where are you come from? Because I know from the YouTube chat here, you are from Vietnam, Cambodia, Indonesia, Malaysia, India,
Myanmar,
and then Philippines a lot. So we would like to know the other country as well. Please type the organization name or your institution, and city and country, and put in the YouTube chat.
Okay.
Right. So we are looking forward to seeing that response from you. And for the next chapter is about the improving school capacity. And for this chapter, you will learn fit for school program from GIZ and online training to improve school water hygiene and sanitation. And for the second presentation is from LabTech International. The presentation will provide the guidelines for improving digital learning in TVET institution, but this framework can be applied for the primary, secondary, and university level as well. Please enjoy the show, and don't forget that to grab the mobile phone and be ready for the scan QR code or join the registration link that provided by our partners.
Okay, so let us learn from this lecture.
Thank you.
The GIZ Regional Fit for School program is pleased to be part of the SEAMEO Partner Lecture Series. The presentation will have three parts. For the first part, Dr. Juan Alfonso Leonardia, Regional Program Coordinator, will introduce the Regional Fit for School program.
The GIZ Regional Fit for School program has been working in Cambodia, Indonesia, Lao PDR in the Philippines since 2011, starting with a scalable model for managing and implementing water, sanitation, and hygiene in schools, or WINS. Over the years, the model has been integrated into national WINS policies, guidelines, and programs, and thus scaling up the model became a government-led process. On its third program phase, The program is supporting these governments in the attainment of nationally determined standards and milestones for attaining the global wins-related sustainable development goals that I will describe in detail towards the end of this section. The Fit for School program collaborates with SEAMEO Innotech as its regional partner, specifically on capacity development products and platforms, such as massive open online courses, and knowledge management, such as learning exchanges and publications. Furthermore, thematic collaborations have also been established with other SEAMEO centers, such as with RECFUND in Indonesia and CED in Lao PDR. In this diagram, simple and system-oriented are how we work and design the program interventions, and scalable and sustainable is what we would like to achieve. In order to reach scale and sustainability, programs and interventions need to be simple and embedded in the system. Since the systems we work with are usually in the developing stage, only simple solutions can be absorbed and sustained by the system. Thus, if the goal is scale and sustainability, we need to keep two things in mind. Keep it simple and work through the system. On the school level, the Fit for School program focused on daily hygiene practices such as group hand washing with soap and toothbrushing with fluoride toothpaste. Other interventions comprise biannual school-based deworming, distribution of information materials on menstrual health and hygiene, and integrated wash and school feeding activities. School management received guidance and tools to set up and monitor processes and to ensure regular operation and maintenance of the needed facilities. The practical model was meant to be doable with resources existing in most schools. Together with responsive management and the help of stakeholders in the school community, the provision of basic wash services in schools are within reach. Over the years, the program continued to support the government-led scale-up by providing technical assistance for strengthening national and subnational management processes, particularly capacity development aimed at mass scale, wins monitoring and recognition systems for triggering action, and learning exchange and knowledge management for sharing innovations and practical solutions for continuous improvement. Washing schools is a basic right, and this is affirmed by its inclusion in the SDGs. SDG 6 aims for universal access, which goes beyond households and includes wash in institutional settings. SDG 4 has a target on effective learning environments, which includes basic drinking water, sanitation, and hygiene in schools. The recent COVID-19 pandemic has emphasized the importance of WINS as a prerequisite for the safe reopening of schools. Hence, ensuring that all schools have the capacities for managing WASH is more relevant than ever.
Now, let us learn the goals of WINS and how it contributes to the achievement of sustainable development goals through this video.
Education requires a healthy and enabling environment. For students to learn, they should have access to clean water, functional toilets, and be able to practice proper hygiene. Access to wash in schools, or WINS, is a right of every child, and schools are responsible in providing a healthy and conducive learning environment. WINS is one of the most basic aspects in ensuring that children are ready for learning. By addressing WASH in schools, you are helping to prevent hygiene-related diseases, promote positive behavior and life skills, improve attendance and participation, help them thrive and learn better, promote gender equality, and affirm children's right to health and education. At the global level, WASH in schools supports the attainment of two of the Sustainable Development Goals, namely, SDG 4, ensure inclusive and equitable quality education and promote lifelong learning opportunities for all. And SDG 6, ensure availability and sustainable management of water and sanitation for all.
In the Philippines, results of the WINS baseline monitoring in the school year 2017-2018 showed that more than half of participating schools had not reached even the most basic WINS standards. The situation calls for large-scale support on implementation and capacity development on WINS to reach the grassroots level. But the question is, how can and how should we do it? At this point, let us learn about the massive open online course on WINS.
Face-to-face training on WINS at nationwide scale would pose substantial logistic challenges, considering that the Philippines is an archipelagic country with an estimated of 46,000 schools nationwide. In response to this, WINS massive open online courses were developed by GIZ through its regional Fit for School program and in partnership with SEAMEO Innotech to support the Philippine DepEd's rollout of its WINS policy. Two self-paced MOOCs, Leading WINS and Accelerating WINS, were developed for this purpose. By building capacities on WINS, it ultimately aims to improve the WASH conditions in schools and create a safe, conducive learning environment for the learners. Amidst this pandemic, online solutions are a feasible approach to reach our target audience at scale, and the WINS MOOCs were accessed even more in this context. Leading WINS MOOC is designed for school heads and teachers to effectively implement WINS in their respective schools by learning the WINS policy, monitoring the program, and planning for improvements. The Leading WINS course is divided into 6 modules. Introduction provides an overview and guide to the participants as they go along with the course. Understanding WINS, participants will learn about the 5 WINS elements and its implementation, and how the participants will advocate WINS to the schools and stakeholders. Assessing WINS, here, participants will learn about the school's 3-star approach, dive into their WINS school situation, learn prioritization strategies, and identify their priority indicators. Improving WINS, in this module, participants will learn about the 4 action areas that will help them break down the tasks into doable pieces. Sustaining WINS, participants will learn about how school-based management can be a powerful vehicle to ensure that improvements in the WINS program will continue. Synthesizing WINS, this is the last module, and participants will learn how leadership plays a crucial role in ensuring that their vision can become reality. The Accelerating WINS MOOC, on the other hand, aims to help the vision or subnational personnel organize, understand the vision-wide data, and plan for technical assistance on WINS program implementation and management to schools. The Accelerating WINS course is divided into 5 modules. Introduction provides an overview and guide to the participants as they go along with the course. Understanding WINS, participants will learn about the 5 WINS elements and its implementation, and how the participants will advocate WINS to the schools and division. Establishing our role in WINS, here, they will learn what is a Division 3-star approach, its organizational enablers, and the division's role in the management, implementation, and sustainability of the program. Supporting WINS, in this module, participants will look at their data and see which schools in their division needs more support and identify what type of technical assistance this school needs. Synthesizing WINS, this is the last module, and here, participants create and articulate their vision of WINS. In both courses, the integration of different interactive activities encourages interaction among learners to share best practices, learn from co-learners, and motivate each other. Throughout the course, different videos are available from successful implementers of WINS to motivate and inspire the learners to do the same in their respective schools and divisions. WINS has become more relevant as we face the threat of COVID-19. In response, the courses were enriched with COVID-related resources that aims to contribute in meeting the minimum health standards and WINS policy as stated in DepEd's Learning Continuity Plan. This section includes a framework and considerations for safe reopening of schools from UNESCO and World Health Organization, as well as local guidelines on health standards from the Philippines Department of Education and Department of Health. The knowledge map from Global Wins Network has the links to relevant materials intended for learners, teachers, families, and for the education system as a whole. Information and practical applications of measures on infection prevention and control and standard measures, including the guide on how to safely and effectively make a bleach disinfectant solution. This section is being updated when necessary to provide relevant references to help schools prepare for the safe resumption for face-to-face classes. The impact of leading green smoke on winds conditions in participating schools was also assessed. Evaluation of the winds monitoring data of school year 2018 and 2019 as baseline data, and data of school year 2019-2020 is the follow-up data, shows that increase in percentage of schools reaching STAR levels was significantly higher in schools that participated in the MOOC, from 11.7% to 24.4%, or a 12.7 increase, than in schools that did not participate, from 11.7% to 18.4%, or a 6.7% increase. This suggests that the MOOC had achieved its objective of improving the state of wash of schools. Thank you for your attention. To learn more about the regional Fit for School program and to access materials on WINS, you may check out our website.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Dr. Stephen McKee, president of LabTech International, and also the president emeritus of World Didact, Global Association for Education. So thank you to SEAMEO for inviting me to speak with you all this morning and on this session for teacher training and development. And the section that I'm going to talk to you about today is about school institutional capacity building. And this is an area that's very important to, I think, in the dialogue, particularly during COVID times, but also when we talk about going into the trends of digital learning and transformation, the obstacles and the problems that we find with many of our clients, customers, and ministries, and institutions around the world is grasping what do we do next? You know, where should we go? What is the most effective for us to implement for digital learning? And these are all questions that are important. LabTech ourselves, we're on the forefront of digital learning, and I could say that we are developing some of the most innovative tools around in the world for improving teaching and learning using new digital technologies. So I'd like to share with you today the framework that we've put together that may help you to look at a number of the issues around identifying where you might want to go, how you might want to get there, and we call it Digital Transformation Roadmap for TVET. LabTech, as you may know, is a leader in technical and vocational education around the world, and we work in over 80 countries. And we provide hands-on technical training equipment for over 30 years in automotive, HVAC, electronics, computer, IT, biomedical, green technology, electrical technology. They cover maybe about 40 or 50 trades, as you might conventionally categorize them. And so our system is both hands-on and increasingly digital in learning, because this is the way that the future developments for improving education and lowering the cost of vocational technical education and deepening the learning, that it can do all those things at the same time. So technology transforming education. Has it? Can it? When will it happen? Education is one of the last bastions of major, almost human activities that is yet to be truly transformed by technology. The COVID era has really proven how unprepared globally education was, and has really suffered during 2020. We really have lost a year, and we're going to lose more time too as well. So digital learning in its various forms can really greatly improve teaching and learning. It could expand, reach, lower costs, especially in the TVET area. So now it's a time to seriously consider making digital learning an equal pillar of educational delivery. You know, not something that's a ad hoc or sometimes or supplemental, but making it mainstream and part of what we're doing. And if we do that, we will see education transform. And so we have a number of things that are coming together here on new pedagogy, which we're calling Hutagogy now. Educational platforms, learning management systems, classroom management systems, school management systems, being able to learn anywhere, anytime. This may actually redefine how we operate schools and where our students learn and where we teach them. A new content, which is arising, which is incredibly powerful and engaging for the students. And this provides better motivation for them to learn. It's the difference between having a textbook with pictures or no pictures. You know, it always engages in the graphics and interactions. Connectivity. As connectivity becomes less of a problem in more countries, it opens up new possibilities. And then as we digitize, we'll get into this adaptive learning area, which holds so much promise for differentiated learning and multiple learning pathways and so on and so forth. So this is an example. What does it look like? It could be as simple as this. You have a number of key selected equipment. This is an air conditioning lab. And you have in the middle, you have digital workstations where the students are learning about the theory and applications of technology before they work on the training systems. So this format, you can, in a very compact area, do a lot of training. This is a very interesting chart that shows a changing landscape of EdTech from a report that was just released a few months ago. It's talking about accelerated growth, sector maturity, and all the new interesting areas are up here, where we're talking about online institutions, next generation content of assessment. This is where LabTech is working here. E-learning apps. MOOCs is a little bit there. I actually would place it behind even LMS. Virtual tutoring and training. These types of things are very, very interesting, where we're going to get a lot of power from technology here. So this is our major framework, graphic, infographic for the digital TVET development framework. And we have this divided up into three areas that we call the three I's: the infrastructure, and infoculture. And these are the three areas that you need to look at to balance and develop your framework and your roadmap of how you're going to do it. And this gives you the points to think through. Like in infrastructure, you'll need to consider hardware. You'll need to consider integration, support, connection, connectivity, and bandwidth. All this has to be done with your objectives and goals in mind. So you need to look at where you are in this area and where you want to go. In the infrastructure, you have to look at the software, the applications you're going to use, the acquisition of those applications, the platforms that you're going to use, the learning management systems, the school management systems, the content management systems, the content itself. And there's two types of content in here. There's content that can be developed by teachers, and there's content that should be professionally developed that schools typically use, which are applications, which, you know, in the past it's been professionally written books and videos and so on and so forth. There's also a new generation of content of like the type that LabTech develops that's beyond what a teacher or even an institution can develop, because it takes a very wide collaborative effort. It's like a movie studio, you know, what we do to engage in that. And then assessment. The new types of assessment are really, really interesting. We can do assessment in a far, far different way and even get into good formative assessment. Then we have the infoculture, which is the curriculum, because we need to change the curriculum to include digital learning in the curriculum, not just lecture and practical, but also we have to include the digital side of where, when, and how we're going to teach that and with what. The policies that enable digital learning to happen and set, you know, who learns online, offline, where, when, and how again. And capacity building. We need to definitely, the major thing, why this series also of lectures is to develop the teacher's capability so that they can be trained to develop a certain level of content and manage these systems and do their teaching and learning in a much, much better way. And then, of course, change management to make this all happen. So you go through a process here of understanding the requirements and the issues and what benefits can happen by this. This will help you set your objectives and goals. Then a self-assessment is needed of where you are, what capabilities you are, both institutional and capacity building for your teachers. And so within this framework, where are you at? And then you need to then from that, from your goals and where you're at, this will help you identify what needs to be done, what gaps are there that needs to be filled, and then you could set your own step-by-step program to get there according to your desires and budget for speed and how long you wish to do this. This is very subjective for each school and institution of how quickly you may want to get there. And what I suggest is that it is a journey. It just doesn't stop. Once you embark on digital learning and go deeper into it, there's always more that you can do and more benefits that you can gain. And you'll find that each year you'll be revising your programs and updating your objectives. And as technology develops too, the capabilities will always increase. And so this is a continuous program, actually. And that's one of the things that many people did not understand at the beginning. They thought it was a one-time, one-shot implementation, but it is not. It is a continuous program for this. So also, you need to take an integrated, holistic project approach on this to look at your curriculum, your digital learning platforms, your school design, your training labs and workshops, and your teacher development. This is very important. They're all related when you go into digital learning. So our services to our client schools is advising on digital development for institutions, for teaching and learning. And we do this, we engage with a lot of people. We have a number of solutions, but we're also in a position to advise on a greater overview of what you're doing. We also have professional development programs for teachers to improve their digital learning skills. We do this because we find that teachers are the key. We believe that, you know, we all have to come along together. And so it's a good place to start is with teacher development and then introduce digital learning as the teachers become more comfortable with that. We have developed a new generation of TVET learning management system, which could be run on a school campus or in the cloud, either way, which runs our new generation of interactive content for key TVET subjects, but can include also content from other sources too as well. Currently doing projects of this nature in Malaysia, India, Pakistan, Oman, Jordan, Peru, Colombia, Indonesia, USA, South Africa, many countries around the world. And we're seeing the results of this now that are coming out. And so we would love to do something more in Southeast Asia. But first, before we get to our offer, I'll just share with you a training program we're doing right now in Peru and Colombia. This is an introductory training session for teachers in how to use digital online learning resources for technical vocational subjects. It consists of 4 3-hour segments. Each segment is delivered once a week, and then there are some exercises to do in between. So it's not too heavy, but it's very, very useful. And if you want to find out more in depth about this, we are able to offer for you to our SEAMEO partners as part of this lecture series. We will provide our first level teacher training course, which you just saw, on digital learning for the first 10 institutions that apply to LabTech from any of the SEAMEO or the Southeast Asian nations. You can have about 2 teachers or administrators participating. So we're accepting a group of 20 to do this. And we'll try this first, and if by demand, we may expand the program. And there will be a special bonus workshop session on developing your digital learning blueprint or roadmap for your institution, because we'd like to interact with you and see how you're doing on that. And if you wish to do that, this might get you started for that. So if you're interested in this, you can write to me, Steve, at labtech.org, or you can write to our manager, Brad Kerr, at labtech.org, also our digital learning manager. Brad will be speaking on the next session, actually demonstrating some of our content in detail. And so I suggest that you catch that. And I really appreciate being with you here today. You can also visit our labtechacademy.com online for our online learning materials for the new generation of content that we've been talking about. And I think you'll find that interesting too. So thank you very much. It's been great talking to you today. And I hope that you're taking back something useful from my session and the other sessions here. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Wow. That's very interesting presentation from our partners. Mm-hmm. And I hope that you can grab the mobile phone on time and then take the picture or capture the screen of the opportunity that provided by our partners.
Yes, yes.
And also we would like to thank the participant for the active action on posting that the city and also the country that you are from.
Yes.
And now we have about 1,000 participants in this session. Mm-hmm. And how many for light?
I think 1,000 joining us live, but there are also others who are catching up with us. There's about 4,000 of them also.
Wow.
logged in and viewing simultaneously this session. But before we proceed to the next session, Piapa, I'd like to acknowledge the question posed by one of our participants, Nelia Grape, asking about how to participate with the MOOCs on WINS. So maybe you can view this session after and you can take a screenshot of the contact details of our partner from GIZ.
That's right.
And you can email them directly. And also, we'd like to acknowledge the photo posted and used by our participant from Irene Lopez. So she has posted her photo and she used the hashtag SEAMEO-Partners.
Yeah, on the Facebook, right?
On her Facebook account. So if you post your photos, how you're enjoying, how you're learning from this session, and then when you post it, you use the hashtag SEAMEO-Partners, will be able to see it.
Yes, or you can capture or take the photo of the partners that you like and then just post it on your Facebook and hashtag SEAMEO-Partners and one word together, right?
SEAMEO-Partners. No space.
Yes.
Okay. So with that, let's proceed. After learning from improving school capacity, let's now proceed to the innovative teacher training. So we have two lecturers. The first one is from Acadasia in Singapore, the co-founder and CEO, Mr. Nilesh Bhatia, and he will be talking about redesigning classroom-based lessons for teaching online, to be followed by Vex Robotics. I think on our YouTube Live, we have our friends, our partners from Vex Robotics joining us on YouTube. So if you have questions that would strike your interest, you can also post it. And I'm sure our partner from Vex Robotics would be willing to respond to your question, because Mr. Jason McKenna, Director Global Educational Strategy and former classroom teacher, will talk about the 2021 Computer Science Teacher Training and Online Resources, Upskill and Prepare for Your Future. So all of us, let us enjoy and learn from these lectures from our two partners.
My name is Nilesh Bhatia, and I am the CEO and the co-founder of AcadAsia. Before I begin today's session on redesigning classroom-based lessons for teaching online, I would like to take this opportunity to thank the entire team from SEAMEO for organizing this event and for inviting us to be a part of it. Thank you, SEAMEO, and also thank you to all the attendees who have taken time out from their busy schedules to be here with us today. At AcadAsia, we are a Singapore-based mission-driven edtech business that aims to empower educators everywhere. We do this through Friju, the largest online community of teachers in Asia. Currently, the community is more than 50,000 teachers strong, and the teachers join Friju to access the various professional development courses on the platform, which allow them to upskill themselves with the pedagogical and the technical skills needed to teach the 21st century learners. The professional development courses are currently available in English, Bahasa Indonesia, Hindi, and Mongolian. Use of technology in education is nothing new. In fact, even during classroom-based lessons, chances are that you've used technology in one way or the other. You may have used a laptop and PowerPoint to make a presentation, perhaps, or maybe used a visualizer on the classroom to project notes, or a textbook maybe. Or even at a much more rudimentary level, you may have used a blackboard or a whiteboard with chalk or markers. These two, in one way or the other, are all forms of technology. But even then, a lot of us still have misconceptions about technology in an online teaching and a learning environment. Many of us may be of the opinion that video conferencing apps provide the best and the easiest way to teach a class, that perhaps online classes lack rigor, or that we can just use our material from classroom-based lessons and use this to teach online. Some of us may also believe that online classes do not provide the most engaging environment for the learners to learn. My objective today, therefore, is to help you clear these misconceptions at a very basic level. In the next few minutes, I will show you how I prepare myself to teach online, how I curate my lesson material, And I will also demonstrate this with a real example. And finally, I will touch upon very briefly on how we might build more engaging lessons for our learners. Over the last year now, I have been working very closely with teachers from all around Asia, and I find that there are sins these days. First of all, I find that many people are obsessed with technology. What learning management platforms should we use? What features does this have? How easy or difficult it is to use, etc. Unfortunately, we seem to have forgotten that at the end of the day, the content and the design of your lesson is inherently more important than what technology platform you use to deliver your lessons with. And because of this obsession over technology, many of us tend to forget the basic principles of lesson planning and instead just try to do whatever it is that we were doing in a classroom, but now on a video conferencing platform, for instance. This results in most students having low engagement rates and rise in stress and fatigue for teachers, learners, and parents alike. So let's get back to basics. Before I start designing my class for teaching online, I always ask myself these four critical questions. Number one, what am I going to teach? So that I can find and curate appropriate material for my class in advance. Number two, who am I going to teach? This is so that I can make sure that my lesson design is age appropriate. For example, I wouldn't want to use cartoonish fonts and images when I'm teaching a class for adults. Number three, how will my learners access the lesson? This is so that I ensure that the technology and apps I use as part of the lesson can be downloaded by all my learners. Therefore, it is important to find out if they have computers or mobile phones with internet connectivity. And if so, what kind of a device do they have? Is it Mac? Is it Windows, iOS, Android, etc.? Number four, how will I assess my learners? This allows me to think through about what I want to check for understanding with my learners. Instead of proctoring a full-on exam online where the students might be prone to cheating, I look at alternative methods of assessments which may be more appropriate for my lesson. These could include submitting projects, videos, audio files, or getting the learners to do small open book quizzes, or maybe even getting them to learn a concept and then explaining the same to the entire class, or maybe getting them to write a reflection essay. Once I have answered these questions, I start the process of lesson material curation. I build a detailed lesson plan, but keep the lessons very short. Also, I think of how my learners will engage with the lesson. This allows me to be as clear, as precise, and as detailed as possible with my explanations. So let me show you a real-world example. This example is from a class called Futurepreneur 101, which is a class designed for high school students to help them build an entrepreneurial mindset. I use this lesson plan to put in all the details about my lesson. This includes the lesson synopsis, the duration, the learning goals, objectives, and the education technology tools that I plan to use for this course. This process also allows me to be very clear about how my learners will learn and how they will engage with the lesson. Then I break down the lesson into weeks, wherein I start with the topic of the week and break this down further into learning objectives and learning activities. I put in a code for my learning objectives. So R means I want students to read something. W means I want them to watch a video about something. And D means I want them to do something. As you can see, with this, I am already planning on how my learners will engage with the lesson material, with each other, and with me. I then add the specific tools I intend to use for the particular lesson objective, and also list down the tool I will use for my assessment, if any. After this is done, I start curating my lesson. Under the lesson material curation section, I add all the files and the links to the various videos and assessment tools so that I can upload all of these to the learning platform quickly and easily. Moreover, this level of planning also allows me to make my co-teacher's life easy too. So in case I'm unable to teach a class, the substitute teacher can go through this plan and still facilitate the lesson effectively. This level of planning helps me make my lessons very engaging for my learners. I don't give them all the answers, but instead allow them many opportunities for self-discovery. I find as many opportunities as possible for the learners to engage with me, with each other, and with the lesson material. And I get the learners to learn most by doing. Of course, there are a lot more things involved in designing engaging lessons for your learners. So if you are keen to learn more, I invite you to sign up for the Introduction to Online Teaching course on Freeju. It's free. And at the end of this two-day course, which you can complete at your own time and own pace, you can even receive a certificate from Acad Asia Singapore. You can sign up quite easily by visiting www.bit.ly/SEAMEO-learn-more. I'll repeat this. It's www.bit.ly/SEAMEO-learn-more. Also, if you need more information about Freeju, or if you're an education institution interested in professional development courses for your staff, then please do contact us here. Thank you once again for your time and have a great day ahead.
Hi, my name is Jason McKenna, Director of Global Educational Strategy for VEX Robotics. Welcome to the VEX Classroom, where today we're going to be talking about teaching computer science with robotics and the importance of computer science in schools and the importance of computer science education. Once again, just a quick introduction of me. My name is Jason McKenna. I have the pleasure of being the Director of Global Educational Strategy for VEX Robotics, which means that I get to oversee the educational development to support teachers in schools with curriculum and training and online help for all the different platforms that we have, including our virtual robotics platform, VexCode VR. In addition to that, I'm a former classroom teacher. I taught for approximately 20 years in an elementary school where I got to be introduced to educational robotics and really see what it can do with the classroom and be able to teach computer science also. The most important thing about my background, besides the fact I'm a former teacher, is that I do not have a computer science degree. I don't have any background in computer science at all. So it's really important to understand that you don't have to be a computer scientist to teach computer science, just like you don't have to be a scientist to teach biology or physics. You don't have to be a mathematician to teach middle school math. You don't have to be a published author to teach writing. You do not have to be a computer scientist in order to be able to teach computer science. Now, a lot of teachers can become intimidated with the idea of teaching computer science, but believe me, if I can do it, anybody can do it. Anyone really can teach computer science if you have the right tools, you have the right training, and you have the right resources to be able to do that. So let's spend a couple minutes talking about, you know, the importance of computer science education and what it really means and why it's so important to teach computer science in our schools every single day. Obviously, computers are ubiquitous. They're all around us. Pretty much any vocation that you're going to choose, your students are going to choose when they go and they get a job in their future is going to involve computers or algorithms or something along those lines when it comes time for them to do that. Being able to interact with the computer is a very, very important skill for all students today. Really learning about computers is learning about the world around us. So just like we teach things like biology and physics in order to be able to learn about the world around us, understanding computers is another example of learning about about the world around us. So it's really important that students are able to learn that and be able to do with that. Secondarily, learning computer science teaches you some really valuable skills that can be applied even if you're not doing something in computer science itself. So learning computational thinking and doing those things is really, really, really important. Very important fact that a lot of people don't realize is that professional mathematicians and scientists use computer science every single day. Computer science, and specifically computational thinking, has changed both of those fields rather profoundly. There are entire disciplines like computational biology that did not exist 6, 7, or 8 years ago that do exist now as a result of computers. My own daughter wants to be an astrophysicist, and she got some advice to make sure she learned Python programming. It was really important. She learned that in high school before she went to college to go and pursue astrophysics. So computer science and computational thinking has had a profound effect on modern day math or science. So in order for students to really be able to participate in modern day math and science, it's necessary that they learn computer science and they learn some things about computers to be able to do that. So even if students do not want to be a programmer, they don't want to be a coder, they don't want to be a software engineer, but there may be other fields that they're interested in doing, it's very important that they learn the basics of the computer science. If they're going to be an entrepreneur, they're probably going to have a website, they're probably going to do some of the e-commerce and something like that. They want to be able to understand, you know, Google search so that people can find their online store or whatever it is. So for all those reasons, it's really, really important that we make sure that all of our students learn computer science, not just those that we feel want to, that they feel want to go be a software engineer or a coder once again. But it's really, really important that all of our students really have the opportunity to learn computer science. That's a really, really important thing. We want to give all of them the opportunity, even if they're not interested in computer science now. It could be something that they want to be able to develop and do in the future. So keeping all that in mind, what does research tell us is an effective way for students to be able to learn computer science? Well, the biggest thing to understand about computer science is a lot more than just coding. Just like reading is a lot more than just phonics. Reading is a lot more than just sounding out individual letters. Now, of course, it's an important aspect of it, but if you were able to sound out all the individual letters in a paragraph, does that really mean that you understood what was in that particular paragraph? Did you comprehend that paragraph? Of course not. So computer science and learning computer science is a lot more than just coding in of itself. Instead, in thinking about computer science, what you want to be able to do is you want to be able to understand conceptually what the computer is doing when it's executing a code. And this is why we feel robotics is a great way in order to be able to teach computer science, because it takes a lot of the abstract aspects of computer science and makes it more concrete for students. Okay, if you think about we like to say here at Vex Robotics that drive forward is the new hello world. And the reason why that is because it gives you a physical representation of an output. The reason why colleges and universities all begin with that hello world program is because you want to provide students with an output. You do an input into your computer, you put your strings in, and then you're able to get that output, that aha, I made the computer do something. Well, with a robot, you can never leave that. You can always see your code do something with the robot, whether you're having your robot just do basic drivetrain commands and move around, or if now you're incorporating sensors and you're having the robot make decisions with conditional statements or loops and things of that nature. There are many, many, many different ways that you can take very abstract concepts like variables and, once again, conditional statements and make them much more concrete with the computer. The reason why that's so important is in computer science research, there's this concept that's called the superbug. A researcher by the name of Roy P. was the first person that identified this many years ago. And the superbug is the fact that students feel that because computer science is a language, it has many similarities to a spoken language. So a spoken language has many inferences inside of it. If I told someone to walk to a door, they would walk to the door and stop. Even though I didn't tell them to stop, it would be inferred that I wanted them to stop. Well, in computer science, there are no inferences. Your computer, or in our case, a robot, only does exactly what we tell them to do. So that aspect of decomposition, being able to identify in the smallest possible part exactly what it is that we want our code to do, and then identifying the specific behaviors for that, that's a very important part of computer science. And that's the super bug, once again, is because students feel like the robot or the computer should be able to infer what we wanted to do, just like you can do with a spoken language. Once again, that decomposition is a great way to be able to teach with a robot, because it just makes it much more concrete for the students, as opposed to being this really abstract concept of it. We have a computer science curriculum that we're really, really proud of. You can go to getstarted.vex.com to learn more about, but I just wanted to spend a few moments showing it to you right now. So just to talk about some of the pedagogy that you can identify in a quality computer science curriculum. Okay, so as you can see right here, this is our computer science curriculum using VexCode VR. This is our virtual robotics platform that we developed here so that you can learn computer science at home. Even if you don't have a physical robot, you can still continue to learn computer science with a virtual robot. Okay, you can see this uses blocks in order to be able to teach. You can see computer science level one with blocks, and there's a lot of research to validate the fact that even if you use blocks and not actual text, blocks is a very, very effective way to introduce computer science to students. The way that this is divided up here, you have an introduction first, and this introduction has a video, and within the video, it's actually going to show you the challenge that the students are going to do in this particular unit. And that's really, really important in education, in computer science education, to ensure that at the beginning, the teacher and the student are both on the exact same page, and they both understand exactly what it is that we want, in this case, the robot or your code to do when performing an action. Then in the subsequent lessons, we scaffold the skills that you need in order to be able to do that particular challenge. This scaffolding is really, really important. It's for beginning learners. This type of direct instruction is really important for any learner that's learning a new concept, in this case, computer science, providing them with that direct instruction so they can scaffold the skills that they need to know so they can be successful with their project. Now, built in throughout, we have formative assessment. Here you see a mini challenge, and this is really important so students have the opportunity to check their own understanding as they go through a particular challenge, okay? And then at the end, we have the challenge itself that we talked about at the very beginning. And with this, now what we're going to do is we're going to take the scaffolding away. So we gave them a lot of scaffolding at the very beginning, now with that direct instruction. Now we're going to take the scaffolding away, and now we want give the students an opportunity to apply what they've learned within a new context. So to kind of review all of that, you want to first of all make sure both the students and the educators and teachers have a clear understanding of what the end goal looks like and what it is. Then you want to provide scaffolding and direct instruction within the lesson itself to make sure that the proper skills are foregrounded so that they understand them. Embed formative assessment throughout, and then take the scaffolding away so that students have an opportunity to apply what they've learned in a new context. That's what the educational research says is really effective computer science education. And it's really, really important that once again, we expose all of our students to this and we give them effective computer science education, because as I talked about at the very beginning, it's very important that all of our students have an opportunity to learn computer science. Thank you for coming to my presentation. If you have any questions about any of this, please feel free to contact me here. My contact information is right here. If any question about VEX, here are some great links that you can go to right here. Computer science for all is a really, really important thing for all of our students as they enter a 21st century knowledge-based economy. Thank you for all that you're doing for our students, and thank you for all that you're doing with computer science. Thank you very much.
Okay, so there you have it, the presentation from VEX Robotics and Acadasia Singapore. We have generated a lot of comments on our YouTube live, and we'd like to thank VEX Robotics who joined us. And yes, I think they are very actively responding to questions to our interested educators from Southeast Asia who are asking.
Yeah, that's right. And also in our Facebook, very active right now with the hashtag SEAMEO-Partners.
Yes, and at this point, let's just acknowledge just those who posted: CL Ping, Amelia Tupas, Oliver Larojo, Janes Tumago, Win Galaron, Paul Redeyet, Jupiter Pilongco, Era Limongco, Risa Marquez, May Apat. I think what we're seeing in the photos being shared and uploaded is that they're actually watching us, learning from these sessions wherever they are. Yeah. I saw one laptop was queued on a big television screen.
Yes, that's right. And also from the mobile phone,
and a number from the mobile phones and actually learning.
Yes.
So now, Piapa, what's next after the session on innovative teacher training?
Right. The next chapter is about the new skills for the teachers. And for this chapter, right, we have four presentations. And the first two presentations are from China. Mm-hmm. So you can learn from China from the Smart Learning Institution at Beijing Normal University. And the presentation will train you how to improve the ICT skills of the teachers at the school level, particularly in the rural areas.
Oh,
right.
Yeah.
So that there are so many questions in the YouTube channel how the teacher can be improved, right? If they have very low literacy in the ICT skills.
Yes, right. Particularly those that are far from the city.
That's
in the rural.
So then you can learn a lot from this presentation. And the next presentation is from UNESCO International Center for Higher Education. So the presentation will introduce the IIoE for improving ICT skills for higher education teachers in developing countries like Myanmar, Cambodia, Laos, PDR, Timor Leste, and other countries. So they will offer the online free course for the teacher from higher education level to join that program. Okay, so before I start the presentation, I would like to inform that the certificate link will be provided at the end of the session.
Yes.
Please follow us to the end. So many participants ask to get the certificate of participation, of course, that we will provide to you, but you need to fill up the form.
Yes.
And the form will be present at the end.
At the end of the session.
Yes. Okay, please enjoy the presentation.
Dear participants, friends, ladies and gentlemen, I'm happy to join this fantastical event, SEAMEO-Partners Lecture Series. I'm Ronghui Huang from Beijing Normal University. I'm a Dean of Smart Learning Institute, UNESCO International Research and Training Center for Rural Education as well. Today, I'd like to talk about how to equip teachers with ICT skills for new normal of education based on what we learned from schools during COVID-19. As you know, China have successful experience on fighting COVID-19. And also we have experience on education. First of all, we talk about the teaching and learning during school closures. Maybe you can see the Chinese have launched a wonderful conference on World MOOCs Congress last month. We can find some experience of higher education actually in last semester. 1,454 colleges and universities launched online teaching. More than 1 million teachers offered 1 million courses online. 17.75 million college students have participated in online learning. But for the basic education in rural areas, we can also see the efforts to make how to make effective learning happen supported with ICT in rural areas. Actually, this semester, we have visited some rural areas to find the effects they are trying. For example, how to connect the two schools in rural area. So the teaching student interaction is the basic skills. And also we try to find the technology to support spatial delivery classroom. It means we need to make the current brand right. The most weird video, clear voices, suitable classroom settings, and full technical support. So if we talk about the scenario of disrupted classes and sort of learning in China, we can see the same scenarios. Flexible learning with differentiated services, diverse mode with selected content, open education resources with ICT supporting, government leading and school-based management, school-family collaboration, and all society involved as well. So if we see the experience in China, we can find the key factor to how to promote new normal education. First, reinforce network infrastructure. As infrastructure is very important to how to keep the online learning happen. And also improving digital learning platforms. Chinese government, universities, and the companies make efforts to improve the digital learning platform. And all the schools adopt the digital resources from all society, not just from schools or the foreign government. And also apply alternative teaching methods, not just for teaching online, not just for move the traditional lecture from classroom online. And also optimize education management with ICT, as you know, all the students and the teachers leave the schools. So the management will be quite different. So we need to ICT to support this kind of management. And also we strengthen the network security. It's also very important to keep the privacy and the data security. Based on the experience in China, in our team, we published a lot of handbooks and guidance for series of flexible learning. Here is an example how to deliver the courses in diverse ways during campus closures. The first one, first type of delivery courses is webcasting education. The teachers can use streaming, live streaming for the lecture. The second one is learning with MOOCs, massive open online courses. And the teachers also can use flipped instruction, global learning, and the joint online course as well. The second, I want to show you the six needed to know facts for the teachers with the new norm of education in future. The first fact is the coordination of education is changed. It's based on a report from UNESCO published in 2015. This is rethink education towards the global common good. We should rethink what the 2 million of the knowledge, learning, and education. The second one is classroom teaching needs disruptive reforms, need to be changed. Actually, it's based from Chinese scholars' voice. For example, teachers should talk less in classroom instead of talk too much in the classroom. Classroom reform focus on global cooperation, global learning, instead of individual learning, instead of just listening to the teacher's lecture. For the knowledge delivered to dialogue between students and teachers, it's very important to make the interaction between students and the teachers. And also we need to abandon the bonded classroom coach with just the teaching, just help the students to answer the questions. The next one is teaching. The teaching process in classroom is being replaced by learning process. It will be changed. The third factor is cultivating learning abilities, both a mean and also a goal. Maybe in future, the learning should be flexible teaching, and the student needed to be active learning. The teaching and learning will be happened in flexible space and time. So we needed to change learning content. We needed to devise teaching methods. We need multidimensional learning evaluation and also flexible learning space. So for ICT, we need to prepare suitable digital resources. We need to provide effective learning supports. And also we need reasonable technology application. And our students can be start learning again, learning together in different types of students. So it's based on the self-learning ability. So it means learning ability is both a means and a goal. The first one is learning activity design is the key to classroom reform. Actually, we can find the same research for online education. For example, if we make students more satisfaction, we can make learning design. It's including constructive active design, evaluative learning design, what type of active learning design, social constructive active design. Actually, these four types of the activities. So design of learning activities deeply influences student behavior, satisfaction, and the performance based on the research. The fifth one is information literacy is becoming the fundamental ability of teachers. Actually, for the teachers and students in the classroom, there is a dilemma of technology integrated into education. It means it's a barrier for the classroom teaching innovation. The first one is personalized students. It means the contrast between different students using different carriers of contacts. So how to make the diversity of students in the classroom? The second one is how to make definition in the classroom. We need to change the one for all. So we need to focus on the technology in which classroom changes. So many technology, so many equipment be involved in the classroom. So we need to manage both the equipment and the students. The third one is digital teachers. Structure of teachers' ability changed in information era. The last one is network generation gap. Actually, all the teachers, majority of them are digital immigrants, but the students are digital natives. So it's difficult to manage digital natives in the classroom. We need to understand the situation and how to overcome, how to fight in this kind of situation. The sixth one is the role of teachers change, but not forget their duty. Even so many technologies, equipment being involved in the classroom. So the first one for teaching is passion. Every student will have their own unique strengths. Passion in a teach is key to help students to overcome the strengths, especially for so many equipment and so many types of students. The second one is empathy. Teachers who aren't empathic cannot help students overcome real difficulties, trivial and severe. The third one is adaptive. Being adaptable is vital for teachers who want to help each unique individual student find success in their classroom. In different classrooms will be changed for different problems. Each different students have different problems. So the teachers need to be adaptable. The next one is driving for self-improvement. A great teacher should be able to look at themselves objectively and see where they can improve. They need to learn the content of the subject. They need to learn how to improve the teaching and the learning, and they need to use new amazing technology. So the driving for self-improvement is very important. So let's say six need to know effect. Thanks for your attention.
...2020 marks an extraordinary year. This year, countries around the globe have persisted in their fifth year of working towards the Sustainable Development Goal 4, quality education. Meanwhile, the significant educational disruption caused by the COVID-19 pandemic directly challenged the continuity and response capabilities of higher education in various countries. Especially in developing countries. Higher education in 2020 has been full of changes and challenges. The closure of campuses prompted teachers to rapidly transfer their teaching onto the internet and digital mediums. Students had to learn, interact, graduate, and seek employment in a home environment. Educational administrators also had to quickly make overarching decisions that would significantly affect all stakeholders under a rapidly changing situation. In 2020, IIoE transformed from a concept jointly initiated by various higher education institutions, enterprises, and international organizations to a global open education platform with ever-expanding influence. In April 2020, UNESCO Aichi officially launched IIoE to offer services to global partners. At the beginning of its establishment, IIoE undertook the critical mission of helping global partner AGIs respond to the pandemic and improve their online and blended teaching and learning capacities. In 2020, IIoE gradually developed into a multilingual and multifunctional online education platform, which provides teachers in developing countries with free and open online ICT learning resources. IIoE has also formulated an ICT competency framework for educators in higher education to build their capacities related to online and blended teaching and learning, education management, and ICT-enabled frontier research. The work and achievements of IIoE indicate that digital transformation is the way forward for future higher education. In this context, IIoE's partners reassembled in December 2020 with the theme of recommendations on accelerating the digital transformation of global higher education during the COVID-19 pandemic to discuss the key strategies for HEIs to overcome various challenges and propel the digital transformation of global higher education. The gateway to digital transformation has been unsealed, and we, the partners of IIoE, will together facilitate the process.
Hello, I'm Dr. Feng Siyuan from UNESCO IT. I'm really glad that SEAMEO Secretariat has invited us to deliver this message to educators across the ASEAN region. The year that just passed was especially difficult for higher education. We all were affected by the COVID-19 pandemic. However, 2020 has also been a fruitful year for our collaboration with SEAMEO and the ASEAN countries. As you might have already learned from the short clip prior to my speech, IIoE is a platform which is dedicated to facilitating HAI's digital transformation in developing countries and enabling educators in higher education via the application of information and communications technology, the ICT. With these goals, we assembled hundreds of courses which focused on different ICT disciplines, technical and vocational education and training in ICT, and ICT-enabled teacher professional development. All of these courses helped IIoE to serve teachers across the ASEAN region. In September, we launched the first of our multi-level training series in Big Data. I'm glad to see that more than 1,000 teachers from ASEAN countries participated in the training and learned about big data applications in higher education. We also provided 10 online training sessions which helped to prepare teachers and education administrators to quickly adapt to online education amid the pandemic. All of these could not have been fulfilled without the joint effort between UNESCO IT and SEAMEO. In early 2020, IIoE is honored to have the Royal University of Phnom Penh, Cambodia, as our first ASEAN partner when the project was launched. With our strong partnership with SEAMEO, we look forward to serving more universities from the ASEAN region. We strongly believe that the gateway to digital transformation in higher education has been unsealed, and the UNESCO HE and SEAMEO will together facilitate the whole process. Thank you very much. Thank you, SEAMEO.
Oh, that's very interesting presentations, right?
Yes,
for the
yes.
teacher, how to improve the ICT skills. So you have many options right now that what courses or program that they want to join.
Yes, yes, and all are for free.
Yeah, that's right. And many participants ask us that how they could, you know, capture the QR code or the link from the partner so that they can join that program. So
Well, our participants, our viewers online can easily review the YouTube link. In fact, they can do it right now by just scrolling that button back and then just pausing it to the links or the QR codes where they appear.
Right, and they capture by
they
using
capture
the mobile phone.
Right. Mobile phone so that they can easily access all those free and innovative online courses that they can enroll
right
in.
Or even at the end of the session they can review rewatching again of the they just click on the SEAMEO partner lecture series and click and review again the whole session.
That's correct.
And they can grab and capture the QR code again. So that's great. Okay, so there is one observation from our staff that when you post the photos on the Facebook, please change to be the public.
Oh yeah. So that we can also see them, because otherwise it will not be seen even if you use our hashtag SEAMEO-Partners.
Yes, that's right. And now at the moment there are many, right? By using the hashtag SEAMEO-Partners.
But then we'll be featuring the photos in a collage next Thursday, because
next
we'll have
session.
Another session. This is first of the three SEAMEO-Partners lecture series.
Right, yeah, that's good. Thank you, Rafi. Mm-hmm. And we have another last two presentations from UK and China. Please follow us to the end because the certificate link will be shown at the end of the session. And the next presenter is from Nisai Group UK. The presentation provides the teaching guidance for online learning and how to decide questions, you know, open question, end question, to maximize the understanding of the students during the pandemic, especially for the online courses. And the last presenter is from China Education Association for International Exchange. The presentation will give the challenges for English medium education. You know, when you turn the course to be the English medium instructor, what the challenges that the teacher will face. So the knowledge from this presentation can be applied for the primary, secondary, higher education, and also TVET institutions.
Okay, so very interesting lectures.
Yes, okay. So please keep posting your photo and don't forget to hashtag SEAMEO-Partners and open for public.
Okay.
On the Facebook. Okay, let's enjoy another two presentations. Thank you.
Hello and welcome to this video presentation on continuing professional development for online teaching and learning. My name is Andy McGarry and I represent Nisai Learning, an international organization specializing in accessible teaching and learning and training. We believe that learning is changing and that teaching must change too. COVID-19 has forced the closure of mainstream schools and colleges and the disruption of many students' education. We have the technology to overcome disruptions like this, but most teachers don't know how to use this technology effectively. Broadcasting information instead of providing experiential activities is not good teaching. Setting homework assignments instead of providing lessons is not good teaching. Just sending students links to websites or asking them to research things by themselves is not good teaching. Providing good quality online education is not easy. We know Nisai has been providing online education for 25 years. As many teachers have now discovered, the act of transferring good practice to online environments is difficult. Here is a selection of some of the courses that we offer to online educators. Looking at learning objectives and success criteria, practicing formative assessment, providing feedback, practicing modeling, active learning activities, practicing differentiation, promoting reflection and review, and questioning skills. We'll be looking at questioning skills in more detail. Here is some of the course content. We ask, why do teachers ask questions? We consider closed and open questions, directed and non-directed questions. We look at listening skills, active and reflective listening. We look at strategies like clarification questions, probing questions, funneling questions, prompting questions, and taking the questions for a walk around the classroom. Pose, pause, pounce strategy. Formative checkpoint questions, which are also known as hinge questions. Reflective questions. Allowing wait time and thinking time. Designing cognitive level questions using Bloom's taxonomy and developing students' questioning skills. There are many reasons why teachers ask questions. In online situations, we find that these questions are even more vital. We ask questions to establish rapport and build relationships, to engage students and keep them on task, to stimulate curiosity, provide challenges and inspire creativity, to stimulate recall and apply existing knowledge, understanding and ability, to check knowledge, understanding and ability, and to identify gaps and misconceptions, to develop cognitive and social emotional skills, questions to differentiate learning, and questions to promote reflection and evaluation. We look at the difference between closed questions and open questions. Closed questions elicit single word responses from students, and open questions elicit longer responses. We're often told that open questions are better than closed questions. But in fact, in general, teachers should use a combination of open and closed questions as a means of directing students towards an objective. For example, we have a closed question here. Let's say it was about a scene from a play. We might ask a closed question which says, which character breaks the silence in this scene? We might then ask a more probing question. What do they say? Again, a closed question. And then an open question. Why do you think they might have said that? We look at targeted and non-targeted questions. Targeted questions are asked of specific students. And non-targeted questions are not asked of specific students. Quite often we find that online educators use non-targeted questions and say, does anybody know the answer to this question? Both are very useful. Targeted questions are useful for formative assessment and for differentiation. And non-targeted questions are very useful for discussion starters. A useful activity is to watch recordings of your own online lessons and analyze the types of questions that you ask. Online education often allows us to record our learning sessions so that we can watch them again and analyze our questions. On this form, we put down the questions that we asked and consider whether they were open or closed or directed and non-directed. As I said before, we use Bloom's taxonomy. It can be used to design questions and learning activities. You can see here we have remember, so we're developing students' ability to remember by asking questions to allow them to recall information, facts, and basic concepts. Questions that develop their understanding so that they're able to explain ideas or concepts. Questions that ask them to apply what they know, to use that information in new situations. Questions that encourage them to analyze, to draw connections between ideas. Questions that ask them to evaluate, to justify a stand or a decision. And questions that ask them to create, to produce a new original work. Now, on this table here, you can see we use this as a planning document using the levels of Bloom's taxonomy. And we're considering what questions we can ask for this learning objective, which is for economics. The learning objective is that students will be able to explain what is meant by price. To ask a remembering question, we ask, what does price mean? The learning activity for that might be to ask them to research the definition using a dictionary or searching online for an economic definition. We ask questions that test their understanding. What is the relationship between price and worth? How much would you pay for a bottle of water? How much would you pay for a bottle of water if you were stranded and dying of thirst in the desert? This is a good discussion activity. We ask questions about applying what they know. Can you think of any other situations where a product might have a different value depending on the consumer and the circumstances? Learning activities can include paired work in breakout groups, group activity on whiteboards, or independent tasks. We ask analyzing questions. What factors might increase or decrease the price and value of a product? A learning activity for this might be to ask students to consider a list of factors that may influence price and value. We ask evaluating questions. Are some pricing systems better at identifying changes in value? And here we might provide them with two pricing systems for train or air travel. One should feature a standard price for all options, for all seasons and all times, and the other should demonstrate a varied price depending on options, seasons, and times. We could ask them creating questions. How could you evaluate the market value of A, a car, B, a house, or C, an antique? And here we can ask the students to estimate price and value of a number of products. Students should have access to the internet to carry out research on evaluating the market value. Planning ahead of a lesson and using Bloom's taxonomy in this way is extremely useful for increasing and improving the quality of your questions. So teachers must plan online lessons carefully to ensure success. And teachers must be capable of reviewing and improving their practice. And that's why NISAI offers professional development courses tailored to online learning. On the screen here, we have the website address and the email and the telephone number of NISAI. Thank you very much for watching this program, and stay safe.
NISAI are offering 30 scholarships to viewers to attend a two-hour future-focused program on online learning and how this can develop students through online delivery. The registration deadline is the 1st of March 2021, and you can register your interest by scanning the QR code or following the link below. Thank you, and we look forward to hearing from you.
Dear fellows, good morning and good afternoon. I'm Zhao Tian from China Education Association for International Exchange, and now work in the Office of China Education Opportunities. With the global pandemic, it is more than ever important for us to work together to support the international educational collaboration. I'm very glad to be here and have this opportunity to introduce you to the English medium education in China. First of all, please allow me to make a very brief introduction of my organization, China Education Association for International Exchange, which is CEAIE. It is founded in 1981. China Education Association for International Exchange is China's nationwide non-profit organization conducting international educational exchanges and cooperation. Its headquarters is located in Beijing. CEAIE has a full commitment to meet the needs of China's modernization construction, developing exchanges and cooperation between the Chinese educational community and other parts of the world, promoting educational advancement of culture, science, and technology, and strengthening understanding and friendship among the peoples of all countries and the regions of the world. The activities CEAIE carries out are to support major people-to-people dialogue and exchange mechanisms between China and the US, China and Russia, China and the UK, and China and the EU, respectively. Provides quality assurance service in China foreign cooperative programs to CEAIE members, and hosts the China Annual Conference for International Education and the International Education Expo. My topic is about English medium programs in Chinese universities and key challenges here. The first part is about development of EME in China. In the past two decades, China has released a series of documents to support the development of English medium in Chinese universities. Those actions were made to promote the progress of internationalization of China's higher education, and the development and the reform of curriculums was one of the core issues there. On the other hand, more international students chose China as further study destinations, which greatly promoted the construction of English instructed courses for international students. For your reference, there were more than 500,000 international students studying in 2019. China has become the biggest study destination in Asia for international students. So far, the qualification for English instructed courses is issued by each university. Some other courses were instructed by foreign teachers under programs. To apply for starting an English instructed courses, the application materials and plan need to be prepared at first. After submission, the materials will be reviewed by teaching departments and a committee of experts. When approved, teachers can start curriculum construction. In the process of teaching, evaluation will be made by teaching departments to ensure the education quality. This is the general procedure of running an English instructed courses for your reference. To ensure the quality of English medium education, a series of standards have been followed. First of all, courses must be oriented in student cultivation. The English instructed courses are initiated to cultivate international talents, developing students' interpersonal skills and abilities to analyze and solve problems is one of EME objectives. On the other hand, teachers' development is an important topic for English medium education. Qualified teachers are guaranteed for high-level courses. To ensure this, regular trainings, academic seminars, and tactic changes are taken to help teachers to improve the teaching skills. In addition, modern education technology, research and reform of teaching, international teaching methods, and integration of domestic and international concepts are adopted to ensure high-quality courses. Here are some key fields universities endeavor to construct English instructed. Here is the data about distribution of English instructed subjects. In the pie, you can see the programs instructed in English available for international students. In the year of 2020, China's MOOC platforms launched its international version and offered English instructed online courses supported by Chinese universities. In spite of the progress of English medium education in Chinese universities in recent years, Chinese are still there, which caused limited development. In fact, not all courses are suitable to use English as a medium for teaching purpose. Some universities are not aware of necessities to open English instructed courses. For example, English instructed courses are open in some universities while few students select them due to insufficient English abilities. To meet the students' language level, some courses are simplified, which caused the teaching purpose cannot be met effectively. In that case, it is time to think about the necessities to open such English instructed courses. On the other hand, to show the results of internationalization of curriculum, more English instructed courses are open in some universities while the quality cannot be guaranteed. Unsystematic disciplines is another challenge to limit the effect of English medium education in Chinese universities. In some universities, English instructed courses are relatively independent when there are no English instructed majors as support. Students cannot master systematic knowledge in this way. Although most universities require students to have a core reference textbooks in their English instructed courses, the lack of core reference textbooks in practical teaching activities is a problem. The lack of core reference materials in the classroom make it difficult for students who do not have much background knowledge to fully and effectively understand the teaching content of the course. Compared with the fragmented knowledge, there are high demands for students to deeply learning and integrating systematic knowledge. To how to integrate the original textbook and the plan and the purpose of the course in Chinese university is another challenge to enhance the stability and the continuity of the course. For teachers in English instructed courses, language proficiency is a bigger challenge. It is not only required for teachers to have rich professional knowledge, but also proficient in English language. In teaching activities, teachers sometimes ignore the accuracy of English expression, which affects the teaching of professional knowledge. As all can see, high demands are there for teachers to teach courses in English, but lack of incentive policies restrict teachers' enthusiasm. In some universities, shortage of financial support, less training opportunities, and financial rewards can cause excellent teachers break. For teaching approaches, some teachers still adopt stiff teaching methods and cause poor class interaction. In this case, students do not feel the value of learning knowledge and their learning objectives are limited for passing the course assessment. The learning become blind and passive. In fact, not all students are suitable for English instructive courses. Not only students with good English abilities and a strong subjective willingness can really benefit from the course. Insufficient English proficiency further weakens students' motivation to learn, which caused some students to complain about the pressure of the course assessment. On the other hand, the lack of internationalization consciousness limits the students in the development of English medium education. In Chinese universities, English instructed courses are open for domestic and international students, but most courses are constructed in accordance with the standards of traditional education system for cultivating students. International students are educated in their home country for years, and the learning habits inevitably affect their learning methods. Learning attitude and the learning effect in Chinese universities, individual variation of students' education background increase teaching challenges. Due to the time limit, I will talk about the way out in three main directions on the basis of my personal views. In 2016, CEIE was instructed by the Ministry of Education of China and selected 150 brand courses which were taught in English. It is for promoting the internationalization of Chinese higher education and improving the quality of English taught programs. We've set a series of criteria to ensure the quality of selection. So far, there were 300 brand courses taught in English. There is a list of the brand courses for your reference. To enhance teachers' quality and further ensure the quality of English instructed courses, the teaching departments in Chinese universities should formulate and implement a long-term teachers' training plan, including the internal teaching trainings, international academic seminars, and sending teachers abroad for short-term trainings, not only to enhance the language abilities, but also to learn teaching concepts and methods from foreign universities. And in addition, universities can also initiate special projects to fund and support the development of English instructed teachers. In order to ensure the quality of all English instructed courses, the teaching departments should carefully check the teaching materials such as textbooks, syllabus, courseware, lesson plans, and evaluate the process and effect of teaching. Some universities have established the teacher's certification system for English instructed courses, which should be promoted to all universities to improve overall English medium education level. In May 2020, CEIE released the quality assurance standards for English instructed MBBS programs to assess the relevant universities to fulfill the duty of developing quality subjects, optimizing teaching conditions and resources, raising teaching and management levels, and establishing an internal quality assurance system. This can be a reference to develop quality standards for other English instructed courses. For teaching materials, universities can work with professional organizations to develop high-quality reference textbooks. Meanwhile, bringing original textbooks is still a good way to cover the shortage of domestic high-quality reference materials. This is my introduction of English medium education in Chinese universities, and I hope it can help develop more good ideas to support the English medium education in Southeast Asia. For further information and cooperation, you are welcome to contact the CEIE at any time. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much for the presentations. We are now reaching to the end of our presentation from the partner of today's sessions.
Yes.
And then for this, from now on, right, we also have like few presentation slides to share to the participant on our next program.
Yes.
Rafi, what do we have?
So for we before we end the presentation, first we'd like to thank our partners, our 10 presenters who graciously gave their time, their expertise, and particularly the offerings that they have for the benefit of our participants viewing online. So now let's go to the reminders that we have before we end this session. And first will be, we're inviting everyone for the SEAMEO University of Tsukuba Symposium on the 9th of February. Symposium 9 on 11th February 2021. The QR code is there and it will lead you to the link. And the YouTube link is also posted there. For more information, you can look at the lower right part of the screen. And let us listen to Professor Dr. Misami Isoda for the invitation for this particular symposium.
Hello, my name is Masami Isoda, University of Tsukuba, Japan. Thank you very much for your participation in this session. On this session, I would like to introduce two conferences. Okay, you see the screen? Announcement of the webinars and virtual meeting on SEAMEO Tsukuba Symposium 9 and the APEC Tsukuba International Conference 15. SEAMEO Tsukuba Symposium focus on resilience for global citizenship, challenges in education under COVID-19. APEC Tsukuba Conference focus on computational and statistical thinking for curriculum reform. Those two issues are deeply related with the issues of the SEAMEO Ministerial Policy E-Forum on COVID-19 response. On this forum, on that forum, the minister discussed and produce the joint statement in relation to challenges and overcoming COVID-19 and improvement of learning outcomes under the situation. In relation to the joint statement, this symposium focuses on global citizenship education. Concept development before and after the COVID-19 pandemic. Best practices of alternative teaching method or modules in educational institutions, both basic education and higher education during and after COVID-19 pandemic. The scalability of national response and the existing solutions at the regional level that may help contribute the post-COVID-19 plans of actions and agenda. The policies, tools, and strategies that could be suggested to policymakers to improve youth situation in the new normal way of life. The contribution of education stakeholders in shaping the future of cultural learning and practices in Southeast Asia and beyond post-COVID-19. The meeting will be held February 11th, and for contribution and participation, please use this QR code. The achievement of the symposium will be coming through the contribution to the Journal of Southeast Asian Education. It is international journal, and the SEAMEO Tsukuba International Symposium are very much welcome the participation and contribution beyond the SEAMEO country, as well as SEAMEO country. Next, I would like to explain and announce APEC Tsukuba International Conference 15. The main theme is challenges, the new normal on informatics and statistics education on digital era. It focuses on computational and statistical thinking or AI and big data. Please see the middle of the diagram. It is a curriculum framework. Historically, when we say computational thinking, it's focused on algorithmic thinking. On the other hand, current era, computational model and machine learning become very much important. So on this triangle, we will discuss the curriculum reform. And historically, when we say statistics curriculum, it usually focuses on Neyman-Pearson statistics. However, currently, it is the era of data science. That data is not the same as Neyman-Pearson meaning of data, because it includes the idea of Bayesian statistics. So on this new perspective, we will discuss the curriculum reform. APEC Tsukuba International Conference schedule is like this. It is a webinar, and the contributions are done by the curriculum specialist in APEC economy. Participants can learn various perspectives. And the APEC Tsukuba International Conference will be held February 10th. And the SEAMEO Tsukuba Symposium will be held on February 11th. It is back-to-back meeting. We are looking forward to your participation and contribution. It is free. Thank you very much for your listening.
Thank you very much for that. We have learned about the conference, the symposium between SEAMEO and University of Tsukuba. Now let's go to the other announcements, the call for entries for the SEAMEO Australia Education Links Award. Please visit the website. You can see the link and the QR code on the bottom right part of the screen. The deadline is on April 16, 2021. And for our next announcement, Piappa, would you like to?
Okay, we would like to welcome all the educational institutions to be part of our member in the SEAMEO School Network. So we welcome kindergarten, primary, secondary, vocational school, vocational college, polytechnics, and university to be part of our network. And the benefit is you will get the information from the SEAMEO programs to be part in free participation in various SEAMEO training and the webinars program, and also joining the competition and awards, right? So you just scan the QR code or go to our website and then you can apply directly. All right, the next slide, please. And then for the next SEAMEO Partner Lecture Series with the theme Innovative Teaching Solution on the next Thursday. So I would like to see you again on the next Thursday on the 4th of February. So too easy for joining us, only scan QR code. You can see like second SEAMEO Partner Lecture Series on Innovative Teaching Solutions. So we have about 8 presentations from our partner, and very interesting. They will introduce the new applications and new teaching methodologies for the teacher to be used only for the during the pandemic. So we have presentation from UK International Trade, from China, from ACA again, and from EEF, and from many organizations like BlackTech as well.
Okay, so as a way to summarize this session for today, remember we asked our participants for their key takeaways, for the keynotes that they resonate with or they feel strongly about. So we'd like to share with you this word cloud. So these are the responses that we got when we ask you the keywords that you like the most or you have resonated or you feel strongly about. So I think in this session we have digital learning, and then we have innovative education, and then the new normal in education. So this word cloud, together with the other presentations, are available and will be uploaded in the SEAMEO website as well as the official YouTube account. So if you feel like you wish to review, you wish to reflect, or go back on the details that you wish to have, you may do so by just accessing our platforms.
Yes, and how many answer for this?
For this one, I think we have more than 326 unique responses.
Wow, okay.
So we'd like to thank all our participants. I think you will see that the image is evolving because as we speak, there are some who are still providing their feedback, and it works like the on the frequency. The ones with the bigger font means that they are the most repeated, the most cited keywords.
All right.
So we thank our participants. So I hope that you have learned so much and you have taken note of all these offerings from our partners so that it will also be benefiting your school and your learners as well.
Okay, that's great.
Thank you very much for that. And at this point, we're inviting you to give us your photos by submitting to them your email because we want to see your voices. You may still email us at webinar@seameo.org, or you may also upload them on your Facebook accounts and just use the hashtag SEAMEO-Partners.
Yes, that's right.
So next Thursday we'll be showing you a collage probably of all the submissions that we had.
Because
we want to know. We want to see your context, how you are operating, how you're benefiting from this lecture series, how you're sharing the knowledge that you have with your co-teachers, colleagues.
Yes, that's right.
And even in your learners. Okay, so Piapa, would you like to present the most asked question at this point?
Yes, and for the participant who would like to get a e-certificate of participation of the session of today, you can access the link that's shown on the screen. And our team will pin the link on the YouTube channel.
Yeah, okay.
Right, you just click on the pin and then you can access the link directly. Mm-hmm. And scan QR code and you will find like very simple question asking you about the evaluation and your contact details. And the deadline of the link is tonight at nearly midnight time. Wow. So you have about 12 hours to fill up. And please ensure spelling of full name and email address before submitting, because we use the system to generate e-certificate to you. So we are not able to fix the certificate after sending to you. And please bear for us because it takes about 1 month to generate certificate. And mostly for our webinar session, we aim to have like almost 5,000 participants, mm-hmm. you know, rewatching and fill up in the certificate validation form. So please give time for our team to generate the certificate for all of you.
Okay, so there you have it. So we have pinned the link to our official YouTube account. You should be able to easily click on it so that you can file for your certificate validation. We're doing it the SEAMEO way. Mm. And we hope to see everyone next week because every Thursday is a learning Thursday.
Yes, and then see you again next week.
So from all of us here in the SEAMEO headquarters in Bangkok, Thailand, we wish you a pleasant day. And we hope that you have enjoyed learning because learning should be fun.
That's right. And so, we try to accommodate your needs, you know, like whatever you are requesting for us to organize the webinar or lecture series, and we try to organize that for all of you.
Okay, so there you have it. See you again next week.
See you again next week. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bright and promising future. Creating opportunities.